Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us. This is the first media seminar. I mean, I've seen a lot of webinars happening this time. But what we're seeing right now is kind of a first of a kind of webinar where we don't discuss the media. We did have individual interviews with each one of you. But I think what we have learned in the last 2 months and since Unlock 1.0 has come in is to how does the media react in the situation like this. We have seen newspapers becoming slimmer. We have seen television channels losing their ads. Radio is no better. And of course, the only thing that is brightening up right now is the digital format of it. And I think that is a good thing to be there. And we have two digital experts in this channel who can even talk about that. What I'll do is I will start with Sriram Kari. Sriram is a resident editor of Deccan Chronicle, an author of his own right. Sriram, one or two books, I forget, is it two books, I think, so you've written. Voracious reader, a speaker, extempo, very good. And definitely, I would like Sriram to start with a 5-minute introduction about his organization, or does he want to speak about it, or he can speak about the media in general, the print media specifically, and then pass the baton on to Sanjay, and then we'll go to Saurabh and Shalini. So each speaker I will introduce when the session starts. So Sriram, it's all yours now.
Thank you so much, Suresh. Whenever there's a discussion on media and free media, I'd like everybody to realize that a discussion on media is actually a discussion on democracy. What is the difference between India and China, or North Korea and India, or America and China? It's a media. It's variously been called the fourth foundation of democracy, fourth pillar, fourth estate. We have been told that democracy depends on free media. The four pillars, if you see, ironically, the other three pillars are parts of the government. The MPs and MLAs we elect, they form part of the government. They are paid for by the government. They're protected by the government. Government gives them housing, healthcare, salary, allowance. The executive is the government. The judiciary is also part of the government. Government appoints them. They work for the government of India. They're protected by the government of India. Their tenure is protected by the constitution. The fourth estate, the fourth pillar of democracy, is not only not part of government by and large. I mean, you have Doordarshan, Akashvani, etc. But by and large, media has been part of private sector, including through the 50s and 60s. The newspapers were part of the private sector, even in a socialist government. Constitution believed for India to be a democracy, it had to enable a kind of exception to socialism and allow entrepreneurship. So media's role had to be one of not being part of the government, but a crucial pillar of democracy, and having the privilege and the responsibility to question power, to question authority, to make them accountable, at times seemingly at loggerheads with the government, with great risk. Never do you see a policeman beat any other member, the other three pillars of democracy, as commonly as they attack the fourth estate of democracy. So I've always asked myself, if media is the fourth pillar of democracy, not part of the government, government doesn't pay for it, who pays for it? The price of newspapers is so low, the percentage of people who read newspapers as a proportion to the larger population has been so low that it's the irony that India's democracy for 70 years has been paid for by the advertisers. I therefore funnily call it, but it's a serious thought, the advertisers' democracy. The people who sell things and put an ad in the newspaper. Of course, that has expanded to television. And now that has expanded to digital. Today, somewhere in the intersection of technology, its growing consumption, and the kind of limitations that brings, the nature of media. Now, one of the most amazing things that has happened, obviously, for over two decades is the emergence of technologies that have enabled everybody to be a publisher. Everybody with a Facebook post is a media. Everybody with a Twitter account is a person responsible for an element of media, for sharing some content, some news, some update, some view, some opinion. This democratization has been extraordinary in a good sense. It's taken away from somebody like Saurav, who would decide what will go at 9 p.m. or from me, what will go away from the headline tomorrow, the power for every citizen to participate in this democracy. So in a true sense, in the last 20 years, increasingly, technology-aided democracy has really flourished. However, like anything which is extremely democratic, there's also a lot of noise and chaos. There are also fears now. How do we know China is not trying to influence the debate in India on a matter of Indo-China confrontation? We know that. It's very possible. We have still to completely get a final word on did or not Russia influence the American election. So in a context of democracies and non-democracies having confrontations, democracies with their media, free media, and reasonably free social media would always have that fault line. As to the specific context of conventional media, be it television, be it newspapers, be it magazines, and some of the more conventionally organized digital medias are all under extreme duress. I think it is not something that was caused by coronavirus or the lockdown. It's just taken to its absolute antepenultimate stage, where if you are not relevant, you are likely to almost collapse or close. But like I said, there were two sources of advertising for all media in India historically. In the last 20 years, practically speaking, government and private sector. Now, if the economy has crumbled, gone down to a point where the next few months to a year, the capacity of private industries, various sectors to advertise would be low, they would be looking at their own survival. Yet never before have people needed credible news as today. Never before have people needed reliable news as when something happens in Galwan, there's a pandemic underway, there's a need for people to be informed. And technology, with its democratization and reach, still cannot be an assurance, cannot be having that credibility. At the same time, conventional media, which has to be in a position to confront and ask government questions, are now left solely at the mercy of government advertisement. So this is the ecosystem in which media and people are. People need democracy, democracy needs media, but people abuse media. I think nothing has lost credibility after politics, bureaucracy, police, in recent times as the media. And therefore, we have a very bizarre kind of cocktail in our public space, both in terms where we report news, share facts, and reasonably sane opinion has become reduced to a point of peddling narratives, a proliferation of fake news, the conversion of a false news into a credible lie that soon becomes acceptable to a part of society. We are at this kind of a maelstrom. And will media, will people, will democracy emerge out of it is one aspect, one challenge. How will we continue to harness the power of technology and yet be able to curb the mal tendencies that are bound to happen in a technology-driven or media-only context are the challenges ahead, for which we will have to find solutions.
Thanks, Sriram, for that introduction part of it. Wonderful having you. For those who joined in late, Sriram Kari is a resident editor of Deccan Chronicle. responsible for the editions across Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. May I next bring in Sanjay Reddy, who is the chairman and managing director of Silly Moms. Sanjay again was my ex-colleague from Times of India, and of course has built up a brand of his own in the digital space. And instead of me talking more about him, it's only perfect. He talks about himself and see what he has been doing. And definitely, we need to understand from him as to what's happening on the digital media space specifically. Sanjay, all yours. Sanjay, can you start? Can I unmute your phone?
Am I audible now?
Yes, you're audible.
Thank you, Suresh, and greetings to all my co-panelists. Today, the subject that Suresh has chosen is a very tricky subject because actually painful for everybody. While people believe that digital is having a field day, but I don't think so, because we have our own set of problems and challenges. But yeah, we are definitely better poised, and we are hoping that all the other friends of other media also kind of catch up. But the fact remains is that whether it's newspaper, whether it's television, whether it's radio, and whatever that we create, we are all going to be using a platform called digital. I mean, I'm a very staunch believer of reading a newspaper, feeling the 180 GSM paper, which comes into my everyday morning. From a 32 page, it became 4 pager, but I'm still paying what I used to pay for 32 page. And my wife is saying, why are you wasting your money? I said, no, let me continue with what I started. I know our kids are not touching the newspaper, but they have started consuming the same content that, you know, friends like Sriram are trying to publish through digital. So I'm saying it's just the medium which is changing from a newspaper to digital. Of course, it impacts all the paper vendors who come all the way home to deliver. And at the end of the month, when I collect all the newspaper and go to a scrap guy to get some money back, that thing will definitely change. So I'm just hoping that, nothing will change, but the business model will change. Content providing will continue to happen. Form of consumption will change. And that is where we believe that, you know, we should use this new platform, the universe that digital has created, which with much more focus and move forward.
Yeah.
So Suresh, You can
moderate. Sanjay, go on. I think you should talk a little bit about what you do, a little bit what your organization does, so that people in this panel and those who are listening in can understand what you're doing.
All right. So I've been in media for a good 30 years, and for the past 6-7 years, I started a company called Silly Monks Entertainment Limited. We started as a multi-channel network partner for YouTube. We run about 800 channels today. We slowly got into content creation and distribution for digital platforms like the likes of OTT, Amazon, Netflix. We also got into content creation, starting from short films to web series to films. And we are basically into entertainment, and we are using the platform called the internet to reach to our audiences and make money through that. And thanks to COVID, a lot of people had the time to consume more content. So we saw an upsurge in our consumption of content. Whatever content that we could upload, which was based on time spent, we saw a huge jump in monetization. Whatever content was available on platforms which were dependent on advertisers, we saw a dip of 80% in advertising revenue. So that's why I said there was a gain and there was a pain at the same time. And we are now trying to, you know, look at the new normal and trying to restructure our business model and hoping to survive this whatever period we get the vaccine and then go back to our usual.
Thank you, Sanjay. Wonderful having you on the show. And of course, understanding from you the new digital world, because everybody talks digital now, but I think you were there quite some time ago in the digital field. And definitely, I would now like to bring in Saurav Sanyal, a veteran in the journalism, television. And Saurav, I don't know how to describe you there, but a person who moved in from print into NDTV and then into NewsX and then India Ahead. And Sanjay, Saurav, to bring you into this aspect, especially with television. what's happening to the world of television in a post-COVID scenario. We would like to learn from you as to what is happening there.
Well, thank you so much, Suresh, for having me on the panel. And it's wonderful to be speaking with all of you. It's a great way of introduction. Yes, Sriram and Suresh have been on my shows in the past, and we've interacted on air and off air as well. But it's great knowing Shalini, Sanjay, all of you also. When Suresh got in touch regarding this particular subject that he had in mind as to how media has changed post-COVID, or this is how it's looking like. Now, all of us who are essentially insiders, as far as the media space is concerned, all of us somewhere or the other have felt the pain. It was very heartening to hear when Sanjay talked about that gain along with the pain. But I think for most of us, it's been pain which has been the dominant kind of a factor and one emotion that ties all of us together at this point in time. But yes, these are definitely trying times, which means that, you know, the set model that we have been following all this while, that set model won't work. It is akin to starting afresh. It is akin to going back to the drawing board. So what happens is, with resources now coming under scrutiny more than ever before, with advertising teams scrambling really hard. And I must say also that, as we all know now, the teams have also become much leaner in size as compared to what we had in the past. Every little bit of penny that is coming into the system, that is what counts. So while we're talking of salary cuts, while we're talking of layoffs, things which possibly shouldn't have happened, but you know, that's the reality of the times that we live in. Having said that, television as a medium, a very, very potent medium, does television viewing stop? No. Does news viewing stop? Absolutely no. So, which means that for the broadcaster, the challenge is to ensure that the cycle keeps moving. So it's like seamless. So for the viewer who's watching it, he or she is not really bothered as to what's happening inside. He wants news and has been looking up to a particular channel A, B or C for a long time. And exactly what he's looking at, you know, in terms of information which is reaching out first, factual information, correct information. And then, you know, when you try to formulate your own opinion, these debates and discussions. While bouquets and big bets have been, a part and parcel of our game. And I think of late, it's brickbats more than bouquets which are coming our way, because, you know, we are labeled as being, you know, agenda peddlers. We are labeled as being, you know, fake news narrative creators. So, you know, all kinds of content that we create. I think the responsibility has also grown manifold as far as broadcasting as a medium is concerned, especially for news media channels, because in a way we do know that what we say, what we do, what we project on air, that's got like a domino effect on our viewers. You know, it plays on the mind somewhere deep within, it stays within us, and it propels us to think that way. Like one small example, yesterday when the solar eclipse was happening, the help that we have at hand, and she's been with us for a long time, she came and she said, "Keep, aaj na TV mein there was some problem in the TV, bahut grainy ho gaya tha. Ye bol diya hai ki humne na galti se TV chala diya tha grahan ke time pe, isiliye aise ho gaya." So I just stopped, you know, I was having a cup of tea. So I just stopped and I said, you know, kisne bataya tumko ki ye grahan ke wajah se hua hai? So I was told ki nahi bhaiya, ye hota hai, ye to TV mein bataya hai. Ye to TV mein bataya hai. So ye kaun se TV mein bataya? No one knows, but TV ne bataya, ek bhaiya ne dusre bhaiya ko bataya. Then, you know, it spread like wildfire. That is the chain that we have to battle every single moment. And as Suresh also pointed out, and Sriram also pointed out, you know, when fake news, this entire new dimension that has opened up, where even before thinking, you press that forward button and you also end up becoming a part of the ecosystem, and then some viewer forwards it to you and says, ki, you haven't shown it. That means you're peddling this agenda. Recently, there was a picture from Malaysia. That picture started doing rounds as being of an Indian soldier who was attacked by the Chinese. Now, without getting into any merits or demerits of what happened, what could have happened, that's for a separate day and a separate time. I'm just saying that, you know, that picture started doing rounds, that this is what our soldiers were subjected to. You know, this man who was standing with his back to the camera and, you know, completely bruised back. We did a fact check. We found out that this is absolutely false, because this was nothing to do with any soldier. This is an image that came in from Malaysia. This is dated 2016, and this was in a completely different context. and there is documentary evidence. But you know, that by the time that fact check actually happened, that had been spread like wildfire. And that is something that for us, it's a new challenge that, you know, as television broadcasters, we should know where to draw the line. We should know that what we will put out, when we will put out, and the onus is on us. Trust me, that when I say that, you know, this is something that we as editors, we decide not to put out, because till the time that we are sure of ourselves, not just because channel A has done or channel B has done, because we have to be in the TRP game. Okay, we come out with that. Okay, later on, make clarification issue kar denge. Sorry that, you know, erroneously we put out. You know, nothing really matters. But we also realize the damage that we have done. Now, for us as broadcasters, one new challenge that has come up is how do you gather news? Because as I said, the teams have become leaner. There is this threat of pandemic all around. And we do know that, you know, somewhere down the line, all of us are going to get infected possibly one time or the other. There is no way that you can stop. But till the time when you're exposing your own staff to the ground, that's a call that an editor has to take. Earlier, if for every little thing, bhago, abhi jao, ye kar lo. So that's something, that model has changed. That model is changing because now you will use your discretion. If you say that, you okay, a story really merits that you go ahead and you send someone, then you, with proper precautions in place, you have to ensure that because of well-being of the people who are working for you, there can be no compromise on that. We can try our bit to do, but then, you know, of course, there are a lot of other extraneous factors as well. Secondly, you know, getting into these Zoom meetings, broadcasting from home, these have never been the new normal, but this is a part of the new normal. We've always thought of a television broadcast happening from a grand studio where the camera will zoom in. You know, then you are going to have a massive switcher. There's a PCR working for you. There's a MCR working for you. You know, one television channel here, for instance, the anchor did not know that, you know, she was asymptomatic. And in that process, the makeup person, the other anchors, everyone, and on the studio floor, others started getting infected one by one. So what happens is that when you, you know, it's like a chain reaction that's happening. While on one hand, you have this urge to keep your screen busy and ensure that, you know, so for the viewer, when the viewer is watching you, will not get to know that, you know, there is some difference that's happening. In the end, you've actually put at least 1/4 of your workforce in quarantine mode. The fact is that they can't work. They're too weak to report for work. And your recovery phase mandates that they're out of action for about 10 to 14 days. So what do you do? So these are challenges that are coming up our way for sure. And advertising. You know, advertising is, I would say, the new nightmare for all of us, because every little thing, and you know, as Sanjay pointed out, that a 32-page newspaper became like a 4-page newspaper. For instance, in Delhi, you have the Delhi Times and you have the Noida Times and all. From an 8-pager, it's now come down to just the last page of Times of India. So that's like one page. You know, your sports columns have gone, everything has vanished. So we have to now lay a lot of stress on multitasking. We have to think, even editorial is now being urged to think on ways that you can monetize the screen. Because if your screen, if you're able to monetize, then you ensure that the ecosystem survives. Because without funds coming in, it's impossible to keep an operation. As we all know, the television news is something that, you know, keeps bleeding all the time. And it takes a lot of time to break even. So I think these are little challenges that all of us are facing in terms of, from the gamut of news gathering to news presentation, the work that you had about a team of 10 or 15 people doing for you back end, that has been truncated. So it's a new challenge and we are learning on the game. And yes, whenever there's a call from the marketing team or the advertising team, and I'm not speaking just from my personal experience, I'm talking of friends who are there in other leading media houses also, you know, it's like, oh God, you know, your palpitation, suddenly you see that your heartbeat starts going up. That's because you don't know, because if they are the ones now, in a way that they are the bosses, they will dictate to boss, SNA, SA kijiye, because, you know, this will help us in getting in revenue. I think that is now the new normal. That is something that all of us will have to learn to live with.
Thank you, Saurav. You brought forth that perspective from television, because quite often, along with the low-hanging fruit, that one of the first things that gets hit is advertising. And I'm sure Sriram Kari's slimmed-down version of Deccan Chronicle, the same thing happened with Times of India in Hyderabad, and I'm sure it's happening across the cities. I think media is seeing a change which they never saw coming. I think that's the main thing. We never saw this change coming. We were never prepared. We had a plan A, we had a plan B. But this is something like plan X, Y, and plan Y and Z. So that's what really happened. I'd like to bring in Shalini Reja here. Shalini is again an ex-colleague of mine from the Times of India days. Shalini worked, of course, in the print in the Times, and she went on to the television with Big FM. And then now she is with Z5, heading the SME and the government segment. And Shalini definitely can talk to us about what is happening on that side of the digital field, because that's a big, big change happening on, along with Sanjay. Sanjay, of course, does the content part of it also, but Shalini is typically in the marketing. Let's ask her as to how tough it has become to get revenues for her channel and for others. I'm sure she also has a presentation which she will present in the second half of the round of discussion that we're having.
Thank you, Suresh, and welcome to all my co-speakers. It's great to, you know, be having this conversation today. So I will talk about OTT and I will talk about Z5, and not only from the sales perspective, but, you know, right now for us, it's one of the most exciting times, because we've seen such a huge growth in the last, especially after the, you know, the lockdown has happened. Our numbers on the subscriptions have rising up, you know, are rising every day, you know, because today there is no other content to watch on television, you know, apart from news. So Z5, and not only Z5, but all the other OTT platforms and the other digital platforms are seeing a humongous increase in viewership. You know, people who've never watched OTT are now buying subscriptions, are, you know, watching a lot of web series, a lot of web content. In fact, I have never, you know, I mean, though I've been with Z5 now since the last 1.5 years, but honestly, I never got the time to really sit down and even watch a Netflix or an Amazon Prime or, you know, or my own Z5. But, you know, in the last 3 months, I think it's been amazing content, you know, which you really get, you know, at your own convenience, you know. So you're watching the content, whatever you like, you know, in the privacy of your own room. You know, you can switch it off, switch it on again, you know, again at any given point of time, and you're not restricted like the television channels. What Z5 has, you know, done very amazingly in the last, you know, 2.5 years, while since, you know, Z5 has been here, that we've not kind of limited ourselves to metros or the cities. So we've expanded ourselves into, you know, complete all over India. So we are more vernacular, more regional. And in fact, that's something which I would be talking, you know, during my presentation, that today we are not making very premium content. We are making content for the masses. Okay. And that's something, you know, which, I mean, anybody today who has a smartphone, and today we know that Jio coming in, you know, with the 4G, you know, internet speeds up very, very fast, you know, the data is really very inexpensive. So today more and more number of people have handsets, right? And with Z5, what we are seeing today is, because Z5 does not have only premium, you know, the web series content, we also have the ZTV series, you know, which is basically, Z has 54 channels across India. So that was always there with people. People were watching, you know, all the TV series, you know, including the, you know, the housewives in their houses, you know, a security guy, a common person, you know, our maid servants, you know, you see, I mean, I live in Bombay, but I guess that's the way it's everywhere. Today, you see every person, you know, looking at content on their phones. So that's where the entire viewership is really coming from. And it's so nice to see that today, somebody who cannot afford a television at home can actually consume content on their cell phones, right? That's the beauty of it. And today, of course, Z5, you know, in the last, especially after the COVID lockdown, I mean, we are one of the only OTTs, you know, I mean, when I say OTTs, I compare it with the Hotstar or the Sony Liz or the Woods, etc., that we are the only OTT platform which has come up with a huge amount of content. I mean, something which we've been kind of producing, you know, even within the lockdown, we've actually been able to shoot some stuff, you know, in a single room kind of a format, you know. So we've actually had a lot of new movie releases on Z5. So, you know, there is this new movie called Chintu Ka Birthday. I don't know how many people have seen it here, but it's a huge hit. It's a very, very emotional short movie about this small kid, you know, how he wants to celebrate his birthday, but, you know, because of the war in Saudi Arabia, he's not able to. beautiful movie. I would recommend that everybody watches it. But I'm saying that even, you know, with the lockdown, there is so much of content, you know, we've been able to acquire, put it on the platform. And the way the numbers, the subscriptions are improving and, you know, increasing every day. I mean, it's really very terrific. So goes without saying, I think internet OTT is something which, you know, a lot of people would want to start seeing, you know, and people have already started seeing, and they love it. And it's not only here in the metros, but we are seeing a huge amount of, you know, subscriptions happening from, you know, the tier 2, tier 3 cities. And the other thing what we've done very successfully is tied up with Jio. You know, so Jio has these small handsets, you know, which is called the Kaios phone. It's a 1500 to 2000 rupee, you know, handset phone. Even there, you know, people get Z5 free of cost. So that's something which we've been able to very successfully do. Get Z5, you know, across the rural market especially. And that's something where we, you know, are going to see a huge amount of growth coming from. The rest of all I will be talking about in my presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, Sam. You really brought out that OTT part of it, and a lot of us. In fact, I don't find time during the weekdays, but because I am on the field. But during the weekend, surely I go to the OTT platform, be it Netflix or Z5 or Prime, and then do watch movies. Something I never used to do before, because I was more of a book guy and rather than watching movies. But I'm increasingly watching movies, though selectively. But thank you. Now, what we'll do is we'll bring the session into an open format. But I will start with Sriram, because Sriram, remember we talked about this. I had an interview with you on this subject about what's happening to print. Because across the world, we saw print declining. India was one of the few countries where print was still staying on, especially the vernacular medium was growing. But suddenly, you're seeing an impact where newspapers are now forced to get into an e-paper format, something that they desisted, something they were giving free, and now they insist that people should pay if they want to read on e-paper. As an editor of a big daily like Deccan Chronicle, how do you see that happening? Because do you think digital news will eat into, cannibalize into your existing print, or do you think both can kind of coexist with each other?
Well, for a very long time, Suresh, I've observed that news, who will pay for it? I mean, this is a question that we find ourselves in the midst of today. But it's a question that hasn't been answered convincingly for a long while. We just let certain things happen. For example, print in India has historically been subsidized hugely, essentially through newsprint. Now, therefore, everybody gets a newspaper, even today, anywhere at 3 rupees, 4 rupees, 5 rupees, etc. Sanjay referred to it that because it's come down from 16 pages to 8, consumers may feel, oh, why am I still paying such a high price of 5 rupees for an 8-page newspaper? At the current level of thickness of newspapers, the price is very low, according to me. You do not get anything in India at 5 rupees in the morning. You go and have a cup of tea on the street side, that costs more. Yet it's been the belief of newspaper managements, the government, and great editors of the past that newspapers must be as inexpensive as possible. Of course, certain media houses, and I won't name them here, but it looks like some of you have worked for it in the past, has also created this context of 1 rupee newspaper, and that was the idea. So basically, you said the reader is not a consumer. He is the product. I will take the excuse of news to ensure 10 lakhs, 20 lakh people get my paper. They look at the news at what Saurav described as the screen, create the opportunity for the advertiser. So essentially, newspaper was not a high value product you created for a discerning customer, but you created an opportunity for advertisers to get dumped free of cost early in the morning at the lowest price possible. And you told them, not only is the newspaper 2 rupees, 3 rupees, you pay 90 rupees for a month if it is 3 rupees, but you actually end selling half of it this extended to television when it came packaged in satellite pre-internet OTT context. So television channels were being consumed as well, and most of them are free. So everything, the news is free. Customer doesn't believe news is something worthy of paying properly for. If you contrast the price of a newspaper in America, in Europe, I can understand the difference. And as somebody who's written, as you know, Suresh, for a Guardian or a New York Times, when I'd ask my friends in London or New York to buy a copy and send it to me, and I'd be surprised if selling at £2 and $2, etc. And in India, in contrast, what I write sells for 3 rupees. But in Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Philippines, I'm surprised Sri Lanka newspapers sell at 75 rupees. And I think the prices will go up. So which otherwise what it means is print in the paper format is going to become a product for a smaller number of highly discerning, highly engaged set of customers who wouldn't mind paying in the very near future 10 rupees, but maybe in the next 12 months as high as 50 rupees a day. Maybe, I hope it gets to that. And therefore the advertisers will target them very differently. But since we have created this news, since we have collected so much news, we will have a web version which will have a hybrid model of paid versus free, where we, the New York Times or New Yorker or the some models like those where you get 10 articles per month free, or maybe the Wall Street Journal model of you get the first 2 paragraphs of the piece free and then you have to be a paid subscriber to see it more, etc. So these are the models that will create where a newspaper office, the newsroom of a newspaper office will be a news creating agency, which will have 2 very different products out there. A premium compared to today, much higher priced paper, which lands in your doorstep. And if you buy the newspaper in that form, you'll get the web free. And those on the web, but essentially this question is open for everybody. If the end consumer will not pay for the newspaper, if I will not pay even 100 rupees a month to Saurav's channel to watch him give me news, then he has starting to lose responsibility towards me. And he will have to cater to the advertiser. If the subscriber can give minimum sustenance and moderately sustainable profits, I mean, no Indian will mind paying Shalini $200. I don't know how much Z5 costs per month or whatever, but I'm happily like everybody else in lockdown. Every time I watch a promo, I try to watch the entire film and it says, hey, you're not subscribed to Disney, Hotstar or Z. And I say, hey, I tell my wife, why don't you subscribe? And I'm paying. But to say the same people will not mind paying 500 rupees to watch a news channel or to read newspaper per month, then it is well possible that this MND segment, media and entertainment, the M will die. Entertainment will sustain, of course. Bollywood sustains, everything fine. The media, those people, as Saurav said, who will say, sorry, this picture is not in the Indo-China border. I bring my valued professional judgment to say, this is not that, it's an older picture and you have to pay. And if you're not willing to pay, that media will die. And then I would like to tell everybody in this country, if that media dies, it's not about newspapers being closed down tomorrow and Saurav losing his job and I losing my job. No, that may happen. We'll find, we'll go to Sanjay or Shalini for a job, but democracy will die. Democracy will die if people do not pay 50 rupees for a newspaper or 100 rupees for a television channel. And in turn, if the television newsrooms and the newspaper newsrooms do not consciously provide that very perceptible value to people, then they deserve to die. And if people believe news should be free, advertisers should take care of it in the IPL model, then I'm sorry to say, it's okay for democracy also to die. End of the day, this is a world where people will decide what they want. Free media is no longer sustainable. advertiser-based sustained media is not healthy, people will have to start paying for newspaper. Will they pay? Will they not pay? I don't know. But I can tell you this, if they do not pay, media will die. So will democracy.
Strong words, Sriram. I know you really are passionate about the fact that somebody has to pay for the news, and somebody like Google News picks up everything and has it free on the platform. And that's again a matter of debate that is out there. But Sanjay, surely when you see digital in a form that you are at City Monks, how has that, because none of us, as I said before, had expected COVID-19. It has literally turned everything on its head. Every business has been impacted. There's not a single business that has been left free, maybe except for pharmaceuticals. But I think every business has got hit. In such a scenario, when you look at your business model in the next 1 year, the next 2 years, what changes do you foresee happening?
Can you hear me? Hello. Am I audible?
Sanjay.
Am I audible?
You're audible now, Sanjay.
Okay. So before I get on to digital, let me soothe Sriram. I mean, he ended with some strong words, but of course, I can represent my generation. I'm not talking on behalf of the younger generation. When the lockdown started, sir, the first 1.5 months, my paper vendor said, he stopped giving me Deccan Chronicle. And I asked him why. He says, sir, uske liye mujhe Panja Utta jana padta. I live in one corner of the city called Financial District. He says, wahan jana padta hai, main aapko Hans India deta hun. Main, theek hai, tum kuch bhi do, chalne do. But then, while I was reading Hans India and Times of India, I was going online and I was reading Deccan Chronicle in the PDF form. Why I'm talking about this is the brand that you created and the format that I got used to it was very, very critical for me. The moment that guy started delivering Deccan Chronicle, I shut all of the papers and I'm back to my everyday morning newspaper. Of course, the digital version has more pages than what I get delivered in my house. So I think going forward, like you're saying, newspaper as a product which is printed on paper might kind of get very, very niche. But your format, your news delivery method, everything will still be consumed, but in a digital format. So it's about the pricing. It's about the combination. You said, you know, earlier people were paying 5 rupees for a newspaper. Maybe now both digital and that as a combination can be offered to people and, you know, it'll continue. So I don't see there is an issue, but only a transition has to be adopted and we move on in life. Now, coming to digital, Suresh.
Sanjay, I'm sorry to interrupt you. I wasn't, with all due modesty, when I said media can die, I was referring to other newspapers, not Deccan Chronicle. Of course, we will thrive. I was expressing concern for other papers. I'll not name them.
No, see, it holds true for any industry. Every industry, there are big players, small players. So big will survive, small will struggle, others will die. So it holds true for any industry. It could be for digital companies like us as well. So we are not a very big company. We are a small and medium enterprises. We didn't know when the lockdown started. We had no idea how it's going to pan out. But, you know, for some reason, just 3 months before we got into lockdown, we had also started deploying content on platforms which were going to pay us based on the time watched. So, you know, it was advertising agnostic. And on the other hand, we had YouTube, which was seeing growth in viewership on a huge number basis, but the revenues were dropping. So we were kind of able to balance the two, but a large team, a lot of content needed to be produced. We had to keep our costs down. So there were 2-3 things that we did to, you know, kind of get out of it, and maybe it'll continue now forever, is that we were forced to work from home. So, and I knew that this problem is not going to be subsiding in the next couple of months. It's going to be leaving a very, very large impact on the way we look at our life, we live our life. That's why we call it the new normal. The first thing, within about 2 weeks' time, I gave notice to my landlord and said we are vacating the office in the next 3 months. So, in fact, 30th of June, we vacate our office. So that kind of saves me a huge fixed cost that we were incurring because we are not able to come to office. then when we started coming back to office around the 8th of May, I knew that, you know, this kind of thing will come back again and you got to be ready then. Because when the lockdown happened, we didn't even have time to pick up our laptops. There was a curfew and all of us were like wondering what to do. So in the last 10 days, although we have time till 30th, I have told every employee of mine to start moving back to home, create infrastructure. If you don't have an AC, invest in AC. If you have internet, increase your bandwidth. And then we started investing in tools which will help us review on a day-to-day basis and work. And the only thing that I felt was going to be impacted was the shooting for the new content. Now, when we talk about how it's going to impact our industry, it's basically very simple. If you switch on any television channel today, you will see promos run by Z5, Netflix, Amazon. You will not see anything new coming there. Now they are putting up all their old content and saying you watch it. So what's happening? They're repurposing their old content because they have a new set of subscribers. So they know that there are consumers for that content which has already been invested. But if this period continues, I don't think we'll be able to create more and more content because there is fear psychosis happening. People are very scared to go out and shoot. That is when the whole thing will start turning against. Right now, like Shalini said, you know, she's seen a huge jump in subscriber base. I said, yes. I pay $600 to Netflix. But today when I was watching, my kids were watching, they were watching some content which the quality was so bad. So I started questioning them. I said, why are you making me pay $600 for this trash? No, they started arguing, no, there's some good shows, English shows. I said, there are some shows, fine. But on a day-to-day basis, I don't think, you know, it's going to improve the way things are. So I'm slowly thinking that, you know, maybe today we subscribe to 6 OTT platforms that could actually get to 3 only. This pre-COVID, when the OTT started going up, you know, most of us started reviewing our set-top box connection. My per month bill was 650. Today I pay 250 rupees. Why? Because I need to consume news and business news. I don't want the set-top box for movies or anything. And my wife watches ZTV. Now she's also saying, why do you need it? My Kumkum Bhagya, Kundli Bhagya, whatever that stuff happened on Z. Last 3 months, not a single episode has come. So why are you wasting money on that? So, you know, there is a transition which is happening. It's happening so fast that none of us were prepared for. We never even imagined in the wildest of our dream. But it is a reality and it's here to stay. We need to figure out what to do next. I mean, my boys create content. They coordinate with all these creators. They shoot in their homes and then they edit it here and they're able to put out. But how much can you do is the question. So I don't know if any of us have any answer, even if it comes to entertainment.
Yeah, Sandhya, thanks. Sandhya, actually, I want to bring in Saurav here because Saurav, you transitioned from print to television. And within television, you transitioned through 3 channels. And the way the industry has changed, the television industry itself has changed. Sandhya mentioned about entertainment. But news collation by itself, I'm sure Sriram has the same nightmare as to how do you collate news? How many journalists do you put in the studio? How many do you put outside the studio? In these days when, you know, people are just getting COVID just like that, just like catching a flu. So in such a scenario, Sanjay, Saurav, when you talk about television as a channel, I'm here specifically talking about how the news is now collated because you cannot have the old system of having your reporters all over the place. It's just not possible in this particular circumstance. So how do you, as an editor, how did you deal with this challenge?
Well, as we were speaking, I just got this post from a friend. Now, I don't know if you can see it. This is how the office now looks like. It's a prominent media office. And now, we are being told that the office furniture, they want to dispose of the office furniture. Because as Sanjay also pointed out, if a notice has been given to the landlord, they had a huge working space. So they now, with working from home becoming the new normal, they want to cut down on their fixed costs. So they're going ahead and doing that. Similarly, as far as television is concerned, I would say that this is not like a one-off kind of a story that I just shared. this is happening everywhere, and in television, where the urge to be there at the spot, this breaking news syndrome, and that, you know, you have to report from the ground, you have to, you know, show your boom from the ground, all that in a way has changed completely. Because you see, even for this face-off that happened, television channels, they rushed their reporters to, you know, Leh Ladakh. But what happened? They waited for 2 days. They waited for 3 days before actually they decided that, okay, let me move one team. Or you would have seen maybe an army of reporters who would have landed up over there. Today you see two people, or maybe one person, the reporter lands up with a mojo kit. You record and you send. So these are compromises that, as being alive in the part of the game, that all of us have to make. And these are very conscious compromises and conscious choices that we have to make, because we want to stay alive and we have to ensure that the team is taken care of. Right? So one is that. Second is that, you know, news gathering, if you look at television news gathering, one is, you know, your reporters that is coming in from the spot, the ground reporting. But it is processed, like the back end, the production, you know, the backbone before anything goes on air. We now have to factor in, and we have to accept it, Suresh, that this production turnaround time has also increased, and it will increase. That is the new normal. So it can't be, you know, now. So, you know, we had been in this constant adrenaline rush that, you know, you have to have it now. You know, why can't I see it on the screen? You know, it's there on some other screen and all that. All that has changed. You know, it has also brought in a bit of tempering. So how do you do the balancing act? On one hand, that your workforce on the ground has shrunk. On the other hand, there are calls because there are budgets that are involved. How much can you afford? Because, you know, we have had to redraw the entire budgeting process. How much will you use for news gathering? Say if you were spending 100 rupees earlier, now it's in a way been brought down to 40 or 50 rupees. And that also you have to keep a provision, because it can't be that, you know, today you blow up 30 rupees out of 40 that you have, so you're left with 10 rupees for the next of the year. So it has to be a very, very, tightrope walk, as it were, for the planning team, for the management team, for the editors as well. On the other hand, as far as the production goes, yes, production is also taking a bit of time. On-air quality, you know, for us who are inside the system, we see that, arey yaar, ye maza nahi aa raha hai usme. You know, pehle jo tha, wo nahi hai. Somewhere, something. Maybe it's also a lot to do psychological, because we have been used to one school of thinking, one school of behaving. All that is changing. So when you talk of news gathering, from news gathering, from point A to the time it hits your screen, when, say, any one of us are today tuning in and we are watching the broadcast, everything has undergone a change, which is why, Suresh, in a way, now there is, if you see channels which have even had, by virtue of being the distribution prowess that they have, or the clout that they have had, and the brand identity that they have been able to build over a period of time, the prime time definition has also changed. Because as Sanjay pointed out, as Shalini pointed out, you know, suddenly everyone is on OTT platforms, and it spreads like wildfire. Have you seen this for now? You know, I'm being told there is some Sushmita Sen, you know, series that has come up in one of the OTT platforms, and that's become like the talk of the town. So the entertainment editor, the first thing says that, you know, isko hum kar lete hain, because, you know, then we can talk to that OTT platform, and maybe that is also going to open up some revenue channel. See, everything is now interlinked with a revenue channel. Everything is about grabbing eyeballs, because this is what Sushmita Sen is now trending. So Sushmita Sen pe hum kar lete hain, and this is how we will build our ecosystem. So, you know, you cannot say that, okay, I am sitting in a compartmentalized zone where, you know, entertainment will happen after news. Ab nahi, ab the entire paradigm has changed. If it so demands, then, you know, entertainment will be your top story all through. Say, for instance, this Gulabo Sitabo, this movie, and I have never seen in my life a movie and starring Amitabh Bachchan that is premiering on an OTT platform. It premieres on the OTT platform. And that lady, that old 90-year-old, 95-year-old lady, she becomes like the talk of the town. You know, she came into our drawing room, she came into our living rooms and bedrooms through the OTT platforms. We got to know of her. None of us went to the cinema theaters. But see how our television discourse changed, because suddenly we realized that there was this connect between, say, Amitabh Bachchan and this lady. So, you know, why don't we play it up in prime time? Which is why, for any television channel, you know, prime time is like the edit page in the newspaper. When we go to the op-ed and the edit pages, and I have worked with leading print publications, including Times of India, including Indian Express, including Hindustan Times, and from there to now, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock used to be like sacrosanct timings where it was prime time. Now, if you see, that the prime time definition is also changing. Why? Because you have to accommodate new programming modes. You have to tune into your viewer. What does your viewer want? And also, the challenge is now, so when your prime time is starting at 6 in the evening and it's going on till 10, yes, you are putting in a lot of recorded content also, stuff that you've done maybe during the day that you would want to repeat, because that helps you in bringing down costs also. But it also forces you as the editor and as the editorial managers of the channel, that in which way that you would want to shape and give outlook to your channel. The other problem I think maybe Shriram is also facing at his end, you know, there was a general perception that any bad news is actually news. Good news can never be news. But trust me, we have been conditioning ourselves where we are being told, if you look at when we get the analytics, what works, what doesn't. A good news show where we are talking of hope and positivity, which never in a way was a part of mainstream television grammar, that is really big now. So you have to create content, which again is being talked about. And now everything, as Sanjay pointed out, as Shalini pointed out, everything is actually going there. It's not just the newspapers which are coming up with a hybrid version of what will be there, how much of it will be free on the digital space, and how much you would have to pay for. We have realized that it cannot be a whole and sole advertiser-driven model, because if this is an advertiser-driven model with advertising revenue shrinking up, it's only going to die down. So if you have to keep it alive, you have to reinvent the wheel, you have to look at a subscriber base, you have to pump up your digital space. Every television channel is now saying digital is the way forward, and I will not name, there's a very prominent channel also where this, you know, the entire staff has been told, boss, be mentally prepared, we are going the digital way. Digital is where we will invest money. Digital is where we see money. Digital is where, you know, you have to rethink your content, you have to rework your content, fine-tune yourself, and then, you know, go digital. So digital and television, so far in a television newsroom, were two parallel arms. It isn't. In a way that I see it going forward, it's a digital which is going to, you know, have a considerable clout as far as what goes on air in terms of real news television. Say a half an hour debate is truncated to a 3-minute digital clip which goes on, and that is viewed a few million times, and your half an hour show is viewed by maybe a few thousand. So that is where the changes are coming in.
Thank you, Saurabh. You really put it across, because the way forward is simple. People don't have time. People say we have a lot of time, but we have so many things to watch right now. And Shalini, I think you can be ready with your PPT. You can just share your screen and start the PPT in case you need any technical help. Let us know. I'll be going off the camera for a while because I need to kind of set the question. There are a lot of questions coming in from our viewers who are watching you, not just on the Zoom channel, but also on YouTube and Facebook. It's going across the channel. So Shalini, you can get ready and you can start pushing your PPT onto the screen so that we can get to know a little bit more about OTT platforms and what is happening there. Over to you, Shalini.
Sure. Is the presentation visible?
Yes, visible.
Yeah. Okay. So I think this is really, you know, much about what I spoke earlier. So what is OTT? And I'm not really going to speak about Z5. It's going to be about, you know, the general trends in the market. So what we've seen here, one second. Okay. So what we've seen is the increase in, you know, the digital content, internet user growth in India, you know, which has been really growing across demographies, geographies, social and economic segments. And this reach is expected to grow around 924 million by 2021, which is almost equal to the television's reach in India. Okay, and massive addressable market. One second, I'm just trying to shift the screen so that I can read. So there's a huge addressable market as young India moves to OTT especially. Now what we can see here that there already has been a smartphone users, you know, increase earlier, and what we are now going to see is that there is a 2x growth expected in the overall internet users in the next 2 years. Rural will become the biggest road driver with nearly 50% share. And what we see really on digital and especially the OTT platform is that, you know, we are going to see many consumers pay off free TV plus free OTT going up to 850 plus million subscribers by about 2021. Video, you know, that's the biggest, you know, growth. That's going to be the biggest digital growth drivers, you know, in India. And that, like I mentioned earlier, that increasing internet speeds and falling data charges in India has really enabled the higher video consumption across markets, and especially increased the smartphone and smart TV penetration. Okay, so data consumption is really, you know, driven through video again. I mean, this is something which we are trying to reiterate. And what, you know, we see the growth is really going to come from all the regional markets and not English. I mean, that's a big myth that English drives a very large consumption. But no, it's going to be the regional and the, you know, the vernacular and the rural, you know, markets which are really going to drive the numbers. Again, in terms of the digital audience profiling, it's the non-metros which have really seen a humongous growth in the last 4 years. Not really the male audiences, but a lot of the female audiences which have grown by about 25%. And it's not only the millennials, but it's also the not so young, you know, audiences, which is 35 plus years, which has grown in the last 4 years. So the profile of the users to go beyond the three M's, which is metros, males and millennials, and the next digital growth drivers will be the three V's, which is the video, voice and vernacular. When we talk about the OTT market, this will nearly triple in size by 2023. So let's have a look at who are the players in the Indian OTT market. You know, we have Z5, we have Hotstar, we have Sony Live, we have Voot, and we have many more really coming in. So about 30 plus players now. In 2018, we already had Prime Video, Netflix, which were the global players. And there are some of the some of the independents like Alt, Balaji, Jio, Singtel, Eros Now, some of the other players. So what we are really seeing is OTT is something which, you know, where you can actually, you have the choice, the convenience, you know, of watching content at your time, at your convenience. And this is a very captive audience. And now, where the advertising on OTT is concerned, you know, digital ads bring an incremental reach to television. This is a study which has been done by AC Nielsen. Okay. OTT ads are much more engaging. A, because you have a very, very short format of television, of advertising on OTT. It's just, you know, three or four ads in the entire content, if at all, you know, which, you know, are skippable after about 20 to 30 seconds. Now, TV is something which is, you know, I mean, what we've seen is that people switch off, you know, or switch on to another channel, you know, whenever there is a huge ad break, right? Now, what we see on OTT is freedom-based viewing, sharper targeting possible for advertisers, click-to-action available for a consumer to take action, especially where an advertising format is concerned, high attention due to power to choose content, and digital campaigns measured on actual reach numbers. I mean, it's not where you're looking at a very large television format and you're wanting to, you know, where you're not sure as to how many people really saw your ad, but you pay only for those people who actually saw your ad. High reach delivered at a much lower cost, and, you know, OTT platforms enable buying audiences leading to zero spillover, really. So, you know, much more engaging, the attention span is much more larger. So like I said, you know, to reiterate, video, vernacular and voice is something which, you know, digital media will continue to, you know, to drive. So what's been the impact of COVID-19 on media consumption? So what we've seen earlier was before the lockdown, I mean, people used to get up in the morning, you know, look at newspapers, news, mobiles, travel to work, were exposed to the out-of-home newspaper, mobile media, afternoon, you know, 12 noon to 3 p.m. where they had break, lunchtime at workplace. Spend time on mobiles during break from lunch, okay? Evening again, hangout, snacks time at workplace, access to mobile. Evening was movies, shopping with friends, colleagues, and exposed to out-of-home cinema, mobile. And again, dinner time, you know, watching television at home. So what's happened during the, you know, the lockdown? So people have, you know, obviously zero public life, cut down on travel time, schools, colleges, offices shut, all sporting events called off, no new shows and production on television. So limited access to movement, limited mediums of entertainment. So people have been looking for in-house entertainment options. So what's happened here in this time is that print, of course, a lot of people, you know, I mean, for example, in Bombay, even now, I think it's been 3 months and there's been no newspapers being supplied to most of the areas in Bombay. And I guess that's a story which, you know, continues in many more other relevant with no movement of traffic. TV production has completely been, you know, shut down, you know, till end of this month, but I guess some places in started. Digital is something where consumers, like I mentioned earlier, spend more time online than, you know, than before, resulting in a huge spike in viewership and advertising. So the nation stays updated, connected, and entertained digitally. So people are looking at in-house entertainment options, you know, rise of digital entertainment avenues, you know, a lot of video conferencing tools, you know, for office work, shift to online news consumption, and also consumers looking for original long-form content, which is really the web series or the entertainment format. So what has happened is that increase in stickiness on the platform. So earlier, pre-lockdown, people spend 150 minutes on an average per day on digital platforms, which has now increased by 87% post-lockdown. So what has happened is that there has been a, you know, surge in, on the average time on the digital platforms, you know, more time on the connected TV devices. A lot of people have switched over to smart TV devices, you know, in the last 3 months, you know, because, I mean, people who could not get even a, you know, Amazon, what do you call the, any of the, you know, the, I would say the connected TV devices, they've started using now the smart TVs, etc. So the top content here also has been a lot of the news, movies, and food also. And the average number in the first week of March, you know, grew from a 15% to a 22%. I mean, that's the kind of growth in the first week of March, you know, when even before the lockdown had started. What we've seen here, you know, on digital is that there is a huge increase in viewership across the day and during, across all time. And so, you know, earlier, like Suresh said, that he used to watch, you know, content during the weekends, you know, because he was busy in the office time, you know, during the week. What has happened now for a lot of people is that they take breaks during the day. So, you know, they're watching content even throughout the day and it's increased uniformly. So what has also happened is that people are watching, you know, content on smart TV, on their cell phones, on their laptops, across mediums. So smart TV is something, you know, which has really grown. I mean, there is a huge increase. I mean, we can see from pre-COVID, which was at 28%, there is a, it's now at 72%. You know, that's the kind of growth which connected TV devices or viewership has taken place. News has become again a very, very, you know, rich content even on the smart TV devices, whether it's, you know, English news, vernacular news, or the regional news. Now, what will be the post-COVID impact? And what is going to be the marketing communications perspective? So, you know, there's a saying that crisis punish the dithering, reward the committed. So brands that, you know, will get it right are able to capture up to 3 times more market share. So while we say that, yes, it's not a very positive time, but I think this is the time when a lot of companies, all of us will have to really re-innovate, you know, really look at things the way we work and, you know, come back faster. Now, what had happened, you know, in 2003 when SARS happened, you know, nobody really knew it was another pandemic. Of course, a much smaller one at that point of time. People had no idea what was happening and they all started looking at internet and the smartphones, you know, which were coming up at that point of time in China to understand what the problem was. And that was the time when Alibaba really took off, you know, because that's again when they started supplying, you know, online products to people. And that's, you know, when a giant like Alibaba really happened, right? Now, it's not a really, you know, it's a very different time now, you know, not only India, but all the other, you know, countries and the world is fully digitally connected. And what we see changing in India really today is that, you know, there is shift to e-everything, you know. Yes, there are delivery issues, but they will overcome. Now, for example, there is a heavy demand for local grocers, chemists stepping up to ensure they're open and serving. There is heavy demand for FMCG, food and personal care. Now, what is happening is that more time spent streaming online video content, more time spent on social media platforms. You know, education is also happening online. Mobile gaming apps are really something which has really gone up and time spent on them is really increasing. Artists are sharing and doing live streaming of entertainment on social media. Video chats, group video chats are increasing. You know, people are doing birthday parties on, you know, on Zoom calls, etc. So more and more, you know, social media and meet and greet happening. What is again happening is schools, colleges and offices are obviously shut down. Gyms are closed. Now people are again moving to online videos for even, you know, exercises and self-care. So increasing demand and consumption of data, meetings replaced by video calls, shift to e-learning, rapid embracement of video-based connections and app-based learning technology platforms. So push to learn something new. And even today, I mean, if you really look at the way government has come up with, you know, the app to really know about COVID and, you know, talk to doctors. So that really shows that how everybody is, you know, digitally connected and knowing what's happening in the country, you know, sitting in their houses. So what is going to be the impact on media? Now, what we clearly see here is that the consumption on gaming, social media, news had really gone up, you know, in the March first week post the COVID lockdown. So what has happened is that both shopping and grocery apps show a spike in the days even before the curfew and during the lockdown. So really the essentials. So what is going to happen is again shift to e-commerce. I know I'm, you know, it's a little, this is, e-commerce is something which is again going to be, you know, driving the entire digital industry. I won't say really the digital media, but also the industry. So, you know, there is going to be, you know, what has really changed is daily essentials, TV, laptops, gaming sales, you know, all the e-commerce media. What has really gone down is fashion, beauty, you know, travel products like luggage, etc. Now, what we also saw was that, you know, when the lockdown started, companies like Amazon, Flipkart, Big Basket either had stopped or were very slow or were like dealing things. Myntra decided to really shut down. But now all these companies have come back. So today Myntra says that, you know, prioritize all your, you know, cosmetics and shopping as, you know, your wish list. Flipkart is again coming back with different products. So Nykaa is again actually rebranding beauty products as essentials. So Amazon has actually now come back with not only essentials, but also a whole lot of the other products. What we've seen is that, you know, online demand for essentials has skyrocketed. Things like, you know, there is a huge increase for products like Big Basket, Grofers, Daily Essentials. That's something what we keep seeing. What has really gone down is things like hair styling, beauty care, protein supplements, etc. Groceries, again, something, you know, which has really increased, and what has really become stagnant is, you know, the regular things like dry fruits and chocolates and sweets, etc. Health and nutrition. Now, these are some of the, of course, sports and gaming, you know, these are products which, you know, have been really on the demand. So what's the road for Indian e-commerce? Now, Indian e-commerce would you know, is something which will go up. I mean, people will, you know, in the next few months, maybe even possibly in the next 1 year, will be very scared to go out, you know, and that's where, you know, some of these e-commerce companies are going to be extremely active, you know, because they need to drive, you know, whether it's Amazon or any of the essentials. But even today, if you see somebody like a Lifestyle or Shoppers Stop is also slowly going online. And, you know, they've already started advertising their products, saying that, you know, our online sale is now starting to, you know, why don't you subscribe to it? So that's a consumer behavior shift which will happen eventually, because, you know, there will be social distancing. You know, the big malls will still not be allowed to either open fully, or they will still operate, you know, in a very, very, I would say, in a very tight manner. And that's where we see a huge shift to, you know, the entire campaigns happening on the digital media. You know, I mean, all these things really driving towards the digital growth. So what we say is that if winter comes, can spring be far behind? So an anxious nation waits out post the lockdown. We've been like waiting for a lot of us are scared as to how things are going to, you know, take shape. But I think the confidence is that, you know, what separates the Indian community is that we are far more optimistic, and we have a sense of community which, you know, is really there in India. So that, I mean, that's where we expect a quick recovery and are willing, you know, to work hard to fight it out. Thank you.
Thank you, Shalini, for the presentation. I'm sure you will share that with a lot of people who are presently not on the call today. But since we are on YouTube and Facebook, a lot of people must be seeing those. Can you just unshare your screen?
Yes, yeah, I'll do that.
Thank you very much. Can we have the rest of the panelists also on the screen now, so that we can now bring to the close this particular session? I will just have a minute from each one of you before we have a few questions. I've just got shortlisted the entire lot of questions into just 5 of them to ensure that we have we don't really overshoot the time we have. So starting with Sriram, going across to Shalini, all the 4 of you can just sum up what you said over the last hour and a half that we had about what exactly are we in for the next 2 to 3 years, especially concerning media. Sriram, first with you.
My essential argument was media is very crucial to democracy. I believe the model of media, which was either dependent on government advertisement or private advertisement, and the product, the print product, and even television for that matter, or the web-based news being fundamentally free, and advertisement taking cover of sustainability of the enterprise, is no longer tenable. And I believe while newspapers have hesitated, they've not had the confidence to price their product on the web, because they believe web as a technology brings the culture of everything having to be free. Email was free, social networking was free, etc. Now I think there is an increasing transition towards a paid model where consumer pays. Hybrid models will evolve, and I'm very confident the best in print, the best in television will find ways to showcase value and realize that value as well. From a print's perspective, I believe that we no longer can report as quickly on what is happening on the spot as television or web for that matter, which will be lightning fast. We can't have somebody at every spot. What we can bring is make sense of all this excess of facts that's coming in, and the context where newspapers and media were supposed to be careful against the government to be able to question power. We have moved where censorship was a threat to today. They're not censoring good news. They're giving so much fake news that counters you in terms of negative. So print media can do a lot of intellectual, intelligent, commonsensical analysis, help people make sense of it. And I believe there will be enough people in this country who will pay for it, because it's crucial to democracy.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Sriram. Now I've kind of come back to the question after Sanjay and Saurav and Shalini finish. Sanjay, your 1 minute starts now in terms of what you have to say regarding your field, because Shalini showed a pretty good picture of where the digital is moving to in terms of an OTT platform, and also into where the digital finally will end up, according to her. But what's your take, Sanjay?
COVID has come to us as a silver lining, but I believe this whole infrastructure consists of three buckets. The enabler bucket was the internet, which helped us grow during these times. And the second bucket, which was the consumer, the subscriber, you know, latched on to it because they only got some good content, high standard coming onto these platforms, and they paid for it. The third bucket, which is where my worry is the content bucket. I mean, while we are all growing, there's lots happening, but if this thing continues and we do not get vaccine soon enough, we'll not be able to create content of that standard the way it was happening all this while. So if that has to continue, we have to look at creating content in a different manner so that we can keep feeding the requirements what the subscribers have.
Thank you, Sanjay. I'll just come back to you. You have a question from one of the participants here, so I'll come back to you after this. Shalini answer the final question. It's something very related to what you're speaking of right now. Saurabh, coming to you, you did say that there is going to be a marriage between, you know, television on screen and digital is going to kind of go short. So, Saurabh, your 1 minute starts now.
Well, I think the whole model of television news presentation, that will undergo a sea change for sure, because as I said, it's going to be digital. And digital will now be the guiding compass, so to say, as far as what works for TV and what doesn't. That also is concerned. So, you know, the glass ceiling that existed, that moral high ground in a way that existed between one department versus the other, that glass ceiling has been shattered. That wall, that invisible wall that used to be there, that has been shattered. It's now time to work together more cohesively so that the audience, at the end of it all, gets what the audience wants. Because, you know, here, like all other OTT platforms in television also, it just takes a second for you to change your remote if you don't want. Also, internally speaking, it's a huge learning curve for television and the industry as a whole, because this over-dependency on advertising as the sole, you know, your bread and butter sorts of model for revenue, that has to change. It has to, you know, undergo a shift from that model to a subscription-based model, Suresh.
Your question is, so can I carry on? Hello.
Yeah. So could you hear me?
Sir. I can hear you now. Yeah, carry on.
Okay. So I was just saying that, you know, to sum it up, one is the internal challenge that we are facing in terms of reinventing the wheel, in terms of what is the exact programming that we're looking at now, what is the right mix, who's our target audience, because with more and more people staying indoors, our target audience also, that map is also changing. So your programming will have to change. Secondly, I think television will now see, you know, English news channel, the high nose behavior that we've often had, that is changing for sure, because this will also now pave the way for a lot of regional, you know, coordinated cooperation on the ground, because with regional channels, since you will not have your foot soldiers on the ground, it will be for the question of your survival, it will be an imperative that you do tie up with regional players so that you know that the bouquet that you're offering, you know, is like a win-win proposition for everyone. Say, today, if I want to know what's happening in one pocket of Maharashtra where my reporters can't go, I know that, you know, I have my, you know, fallback channel partner, who's going to give me the news from the ground, then I can obviously hold the story from the newsroom. That is changing. Also, I said that, you know, that the to keep the cycle going, we need to reinvent the wheel in terms of what is going to work. For sure, there was a lot of dependency also on organizing events and conclaves. They were big money spinners, but all that will now change for sure. So there will be a heavy dependency on technology, dependency on the digital platform, not just to guide content, but also to reinvent the wheel in terms of your subscription model. So it can't be wholly and solely advertiser-driven.
Shalini, you have 1 minute in terms of closing this particular debate and before we get on to the Q&A.
So like I said earlier, digital is the way to go, and OTT platforms will be, of course, one of the very large, you know, driving mediums in the coming months and years. And yes, for a consumer, it's going to be content which is, you know, which is going to be short, which is going to be interesting, which is going to be on demand. And like I said, you know, as per his convenience or her convenience at their time. So that's going to be the king. And of course, you know, regional is something which will be, you know, again, a very large driving force.
Hello, Shalini, you're finished?
Yes.
Okay. Now I'm coming in as a panelist because there's been a technical malfunction at the other end. So let me ask this question to all of you, starting with Shriram, because this question has come in terms of, is print going to be the backbone for all other channels? I mean, including television, including OTT, including digital. Is print going to be the backbone of it? So what's your take on that?
I think so. I think the discerning quality checks that go into producing a good newspaper into a well-edited news piece or analysis could be a basis for television to, for example, source it. Now, not that they necessarily do, but if they do, it'll be very powerful. Similarly, I'm sure all those of you who watch movies know that movies that have been made on good books have had a solid central plot and they go on to become bigger hits. It's not a rule as such, but so the printed word is something I very strongly, personally, passionately believe is sacrosanct and will prove important. The point here is not as Sanjay and even Shalini has said, it's not so much the obsession with format. This is not a romance of some physical paper that comes in the form of a newspaper in the morning or a book you pick up from your library and read. It's not the obsession with the format of the paper and ink on it or the smell of the beautiful smell of the ink on it. No. The manner of quality control, the way it's verified, the way it is redone, the print is the least hurried format. Like, you know, if I get to know a news at 10 in the morning, and so does Saurav, and minus the temptation, of course, to put this story on my website today, I have time till midnight to really vet, access, etc. I don't have to have a camera, just a phone call would do. So on and so forth. So both in news and in storytelling, I think there is great scope for print to become very crucial. However, print must take up the very conscious responsibility of removing from within its ambit those fallacies, those mistakes that have crept in. First, we have taken from television this urge to, you know, be the last word, the most urgent update, the final update, etc. We must get over it. Second thing, I think we have taken from web this whole narrative driven, need to belong to this camp or that camp or fall on one side of the debate. These are impulses. If we can resist, then print could prove to be that. So where internet is about speed, where television is about drama, where it's about a lot of emotional slant to a political debate or a discussion, print must become sane, sober, calm, long-term thinking. That is when it will provide value. If print starts to behave like television and Twitter, then it will lose its value. So that is where the print has its challenge. But yes, it has the power to be a very crucial niche foundation on which others, including the web, the television and OTT, can build.
Thank you, Shriram. That question also was to you, Sanjay, part of it basically, saying that you depend on print to actually hang on to your stories that you create, hang on to the content you create.
Come on, I didn't get what you want me to say.
What the viewers were asking was, the question was, does the other things, like for example, especially you were asking about digital media, do they actually, companies like yours depend on print as a content to get the content and make the production part of it?
No, so see, we are an entertainment network. So for us, the content comes out of new stories, new creations that are being thought of. We do not depend on newspaper or television as such.
Okay, thank you. Shalini, in terms of bringing forth that part, there will be a 30-second response if you're still around there.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so the question to you would be that, you know, your camera is off, so we will just take you off camera. So I want to ask you about this particular part as to whether you, do you depend on newspaper? Because there are so many stories from newspaper that get converted into movies, as Sriram has rightly said.
Do I depend on newspapers? Yes, of course I do. I mean, that's a habit which, you know, I mean, not only me, but, you know, many of us have, are, you know, very used to, you know. So, yes, there is a lot of dependence on newspapers, you know, to really, you know, I mean, of course, one as a daily habit and one, of course, you know, from everybody's point of view, you know, to really pick up the stories, to pick up things a lot more in detail, which, you know, you normally can't really pick up from the news channels, etc. So newspapers will be far more, you know, dependable in terms of giving you the full coverage in terms of what has really happened, you know, from where you can then, therefore, do your own production, you know, in terms of the content, etc., which you are preparing.
Thank you, Saurabh. Thank you, Shalini. Saurabh, coming to you, last question in this round. I have a lot of questions that are coming in, but I will take them offline. I will send it to you on your communication channels directly to each one of you. Shalini, there's been a request to share your presentation by many of the viewers. They're asking whether your presentation could be shared. So we will ask you whether it could be done. And then if yes, we will definitely share it on a public.
Yeah, sure. I'll come back to you on that. Sure.
Thank you. And another thing, Saurabh, coming back to you, the last question of this particular session is the fact that the one viewer has asked whether the mobile phone, the guy with the mobile phone is a challenge to today's television journalist, because he can or she can post news faster, maybe not in a sophisticated manner, but in a real-time world, they can post a lot of news. And one example given was the styrene leak in Vishakhapatnam, where news was captured by the mobile phone guys with mobile phones at 3:30 in the morning, and television came in much later. So do you think that is a threat that is there?
I won't say that that's a threat. That's something that we have now used to our advantage, because, you know, once the first footage starts coming in, that's a concept of citizen reporters that we have. So anything that comes in, it goes through our fact-check team. So the fact-checking team, with the technology in place, they do the fact-checking. If the video is found to be right, if the picture is found to be right, definitely you will put it out. You will put it in, put in your editorial perspective, all this. You know, as we speak, you know, there's this... again, talking of mobile phones, Suresh, we get this message coming in on the phone that the Supreme Court has now given nod for Jagannath Rath Yatra in Puri. Now, remember, there were a clutch of petitions that the court was hearing today. So between 18th and now, the picture has changed. So the Rath Yatra, which is an annual festival, will happen. So how do you do? For a television channel, you have to put out the information first. So how do you do? You have to depend on your secondary sources of information. And this is what we say are secondary sources of information. So we work with a model where you have reporters, our field correspondents in different cities and state capitals per se. So they have their own network. So anything that comes to us, we first wait for the verification from them. So once they are able to verify, we put it out. I wouldn't say that this is a challenge, but yes, how to present news on mobile, that definitely is a challenge. And that's also another new frontier that all of us are you know, learning to pick up the threads, as it were.
Thank you very much, Sriram Kari, and Saurabh, of course, thanks to you right now. But overall, I should say thanks to everybody for the wonderful session that we had. We had a very good response. Privately, I'm getting a lot of messages off the screen. Asked some people saying that could this question and answer session go on for another half an hour? Well, no, we can't extend it because the panelists have their own time. I know Sriram Kari must be rushing to create an edition for tomorrow. Saurabh has his work, Shalini, and so does Sanjay. So thanks to each one of you, Sriram Kari, Sanjay Reddy, Saurabh Sanyal, and Shalini Dureja. Thank you all for sparing your time with us and being with Hybris TV on this first webinar on media. We will surely have a lot more coming up in the days to come to look at the media industry from different perspectives. And this is one of the first of its kind from Hybris TV. Keep
keep watching this for more. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.